And good morning and welcome again on behalf of the Center for Health Security, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and the World Economic Forum. Welcome to Event 201.
We're at the start of what's looking like it will be a severe pandemic.
We know in panic, in psychology of panic, people start hoarding. People start, you know, freaking out and wondering, what should I do? And then countries start doing it, and then there's all kinds of dysfunctional decisions made.
The line between disinformation and misinformation is not always an easy one to find, mm-hmm. And the reality is
governments need to be willing to do things that are out of their historical perspective, or for the most part, it's really a war footing that we need to be on.
It can happen quickly. A Marshall-type plan, you know, I don't mean to say that exactly, but a Marshall plan that can go into effect can stimulate change very quickly.
The distrust relates to the health system more generally.
A step up from the part of the governments on enforcement actions against fake news, right? Some of us, these are new regulations that come in place about how we deal with fake news.
I think a couple of things we have to consider are, even before this began, the anti-vaccine movement was very strong. And this is something specifically through social media that has spread. So as we do the research to come up with the right vaccines to help prevent the continuation of this, how do we get the right information out there? How do we communicate the right information to ensure that the public has trust in these vaccines that we're creating? And secondly, news organizations in some countries are right now under a lot of pressure from their governments to provide politically favorable news. And so we have to think about, you know, this isn't just the United States where we sometimes take the freedom of press for granted. There are countries where the news organizations are owned by the government, and how are they disseminating information, and what do we need to be thinking about? How do we communicate with those governments to ensure that misinformation and disinformation is not being spread?
The truth is, more people did die in the 1918 pandemic than died in World War I and World War II combined.
The scenes you have just witnessed may lead you to believe you are hearing from top government officials in response to the world's ongoing coronavirus pandemic. You're not. You are, in fact, getting glimpses of a 3.5-hour pandemic exercise titled Event 201, a hypothetical fire drill scenario on the premise of a potential catastrophic global crisis. Event 201 was hosted by the John Hopkins Center for Health Security in partnership with the World Economic Forum and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. The event outlined managing disruption to travel, health, economies, and trade, citing various countermeasures, vaccine implementation, and martial law, promoting globalism as a solution to emergency events. This event took place in October of 2019, 2 months before news of the outbreak surfaced. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation coincidentally funded the group Peerbright Institute, who owns the patent to the deadly virus and are currently working on a vaccine to solve the crisis. Please understand, the news clips you are about to watch were part of this pandemic exercise and not actual news footage.
On behalf of our center and our partners, the World Economic Forum and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, I'd like to extend a very warm welcome to our audience here in New York, as well as our larger virtual audience participating online today. The goal of the Event 201 exercise is to illustrate the potential consequences of a pandemic and the kinds of societal and economic challenges it would pose. The board is comprised of highly experienced leaders from business, public health, and civil society. The board's recommendations are aimed at top decision makers in national governments, global business, and international organizations. The Event 201 scenario is fictional, but it's based on public health principles, epidemiologic modeling, and assessment of past outbreaks. In other words, we've created a pandemic that could realistically occur.
The scenario you will be presented with this morning could easily become one shared reality one day. I fully expect that we will be confronted by a fast-moving, highly lethal pandemic of a respiratory pathogen. The nature of pandemics is that many countries will be affected at the same time. This is particularly true with the respiratory pathogen, as they are often transmitted by asymptomatic persons. They spread fast.
It began in healthy-looking pigs months, perhaps years ago. A new coronavirus spread silently within herds. Gradually, farmers started getting sick. Infected people got a respiratory illness with symptoms ranging from mild flu-like signs to severe pneumonia. The sickest required intensive care. Many died. At first, the spread was limited to those with close contacts, healthcare personnel, co-workers, and families. But now, it's spreading rapidly throughout local communities. International travel has turned local epidemics into a pandemic spanning the globe. Just 3 months ago, CAP started in South America, but has now reached several countries with more than 30,000 cases and nearly 2,000 deaths.
Again, you are watching a meeting that took place 2 months prior to the news of the coronavirus outbreak. Event 201 was broken up into five segments, including discussions among high-level leaders of global businesses, governments, policy, and public health. We are only going to show some highlights from these discussions because the event is over 3 hours long. Censorship seemed to be a top priority as the event emphasized the need to maintain the official narrative by censoring social media, recruiting corporate and faith-based leaders to promote government propaganda, while simultaneously flooding mainstream media with the official narrative. Remember, this is a simulation, and no actual pandemic had taken place prior to the Event 201 meeting.
We know that social media is now the primary way that many people get their news. So interruptions to these platforms could curb the spread of misinformation, but could also limit access to information from legitimate sources. National governments are considering or have already implemented a range of interventions to combat misinformation. Some governments have taken control of national access to the internet. Others are censoring websites and social media content. And a small number have shut down internet access completely to prevent the spread of misinformation. Penalties have been put in place for spreading harmful falsehoods, including arrests.
Alarming news emerging from social media companies today about the CAPS pandemic. Twitter and Facebook are reporting they've identified and deleted a disturbing number of accounts dedicated to spreading disinformation about the outbreak. For more on this, we go to our correspondent, Catalina Parks.
Countries are reacting in different ways as to how best to manage the overwhelming amounts of dis and misinformation circulating over the internet. In some cases, limited internet shutdowns are being implemented to quell panic.
To me, it is clear countries need to make strong efforts to manage both mis and disinformation. We know social media companies are working around the clock to combat these disinformation campaigns. The task of identifying every bad actor is immense. And experts agree that new disinformation campaigns are being generated every day. This is a huge problem that's going to keep us from ending the pandemic and might even lead to the fall of governments, as we saw in the Arab Spring. If the solution means controlling and reducing access to information, I think it's the right choice.
I agree with Kevin. This is a big problem and doesn't even account for the massive amounts of misinformation being generated by legitimate users about the pandemic. But it's not just trolls who are spreading the fake news. It's often political leaders themselves. Who's to judge what's real or not? Would we trust every government to separate truth from lies?
I think this is more than just keeping the bad information out. It's also about making sure real public health information reaches the public. News is found from outlets other than social media. News organizations, public health groups, and companies need to help people take the right actions to protect themselves by promoting accurate, real information about the outbreak.
Okay, for more on this, we're gonna get a briefing from our communications expert, Dr. Sell.
So I would start by the social media platforms have to step forward and recognize the moment to assert that they're a technology platform and not a broadcaster is over. They, in fact, have to be a participant in broadcasting accurate information and partnering with the scientific and health communities to counterweight, if not flood the zone, of accurate information, because to put the genie back in the bottle of the misinformation and disinformation is nigh impossible.
My team has been monitoring the public response, and on various social media channels and cable networks, there's been some conspiracy theories that are around about the potential that pharmaceutical companies or the UN have released this for their own benefit. So as we move forward, obviously trust in pharmaceuticals and government is very important at this moment. And so as we move forward with developing the right scenarios, we have to make sure that the public communication is a major part of that because of these conspiracy theories.
Thank you. We have to close. I'll give you, we have 30 seconds.
Okay, yeah, but this fully supports Steve's input. We should not search for the perfect solution right now. Yeah. We run against time. And if conspiracy theories like this come up already, so we are on the edge of hysterical reactions, and then it gets out of control. And that's the thing what should be the main driver for us now to find a solution.
But let's be clear. People trust less and less what comes from government. They're actually enabling many sources of information, Google, Facebook, the free-to-air media networks, ensuring that they are equipped, companies who will talk to their staff. And we know that very often these days, people believe much more something that will come from their company than they will believe something that comes from government.
Yeah. Tim and Chris. Oh, sorry.
No, I think a complementary tactic too is to tap faith-based organizations and civil society and other institutions to recruit them also to basically almost at a grassroots level continue to basically have the integrity of the information.
So I just pick up on the daily briefings or twice daily briefings during H1N1, WHO filled the parking lot in Geneva with the global press and provided them daily updates on what was happening. And I think that's a manifestation of flood, meaning you have to lead and lead regularly.
Scientists think each infected person in turn infects on average two more people. This disease is proving more transmissible than SARS or MERS and about as contagious as influenza. Essentially, the cumulative number of cases is doubling every week. At this rate, we can expect to see 16 times as many cases in a month unless we find a way to interrupt transmission. The virus appears to be spreading rapidly in densely populated and impoverished neighborhoods in some megacities in South America. CAPS is a serious respiratory disease. More than half of the recognized cases have required hospital care, creating a huge strain on healthcare systems. The fatality rate is about 10%. For comparison, CAPS is about as lethal as SARS and 2 to 4 times more lethal than the 1918 influenza pandemic, the worst pandemic on record. Even so, some people only exhibit mild flu-like symptoms, not requiring treatment in a hospital. Alarmingly, those people are able to walk around and spread the virus, not realizing they are doing so. Even worse, international travelers have been arriving at their destinations symptom-free, but within a matter of hours, becoming ill. Travel-related cases have blossomed into outbreaks in a number of locations and have quickly grown faster than health authorities could respond and contain them. In other places, physicians have quickly recognized the symptoms of CAPS and have been able to isolate infected individuals and avoid an outbreak, for now. Global public health experts are very concerned about this disease. Because it appears the virus is readily transmitted through the air from person to person, essentially all people are susceptible. Experts agree unless it is quickly controlled, it could lead to a severe pandemic, an outbreak that circles the globe and affects people everywhere. Models developed by leading public health authorities indicate a CAPS pandemic could lead to an outcome worse than the 1918 influenza, which killed 50 to 100 million people worldwide. Given the global population is 4 times larger than it was in 1918, if these models prove accurate, we could be looking at hundreds of millions of deaths over the next year or two.
This is a plandemic that will change society forever. As you hear them discuss social media censorship in the simulation, we are currently seeing that play out right before our eyes. Perhaps now you can see why the heavy hand of government has come down hard on vaccine information that doesn't agree with the current paradigm, including government representatives contacting Amazon to remove streaming availability of anti-vaccine documentaries, Facebook page removal, censorship and placing banners over the content, and manipulating Google and YouTube search results. Vaccines are part of the endgame solution. However, seeing this simulation become a reality, it presents itself as a planned demic. Therefore, why would you trust the cure that came from the same people that created the crisis? The cure could be worse than the disease.
The first emerging policy crisis for which we need this board's recommendations regards global allocation and distribution of medical countermeasures. And by medical countermeasures, we mean vaccines, drugs, and diagnostics and other medical supplies to help us combat the CAPS pandemic. I know we would all agree that if we had a vaccine in hand for CAPS, it'd be a game changer.
A majority of Americans expect a vaccine to be available within 2 months, and 65% of those polled are eager to take the vaccine, even if it's experimental.
In reality, we are only at the beginning of this global crisis. No one knows how it's going to play out. But interestingly, they've predicted how they expect it to play out, and we are seeing that come to fruition.
In addition to global public health crisis, CAPS is creating havoc with the trade and travel industries. Patients are overwhelming healthcare facilities around the world, including many of the makeshift triage and temporary care facilities. People are avoiding public spaces out of fear of infection and in compliance with public health recommendations. This has had a dramatic effect on the retail and service sectors. Businesses of all kinds are struggling to operate, let alone provide basic services as their workers have fallen sick or refused to come to work. Some companies have allowed telecommuting, but for most businesses and employees, this is not an option. Public health agencies have issued travel advisories, while some countries have banned travel from the worst affected areas. As a result, the travel sector is taking a huge hit. Travel bookings are down 45%, and many flights have been canceled. A ripple effect is racing through the service sector. Governments that rely on travel and tourism as a large part of their economies are being hit particularly hard. Consumer confidence has fallen dramatically, and people are delaying or canceling discretionary purchases. As a result, manufacturers are scaling back production on many goods. On the other hand, staples like food and medicine are being hoarded. Mandated border closures and trade restrictions are creating severe localized shortages. The Purchasing Managers Index suffered its sharpest decline in 50 years, a leading indicator that markets are preparing for a prolonged period of economic disruption. In some regions, politicians are adding to the noise and confusion through social media. Ban all goods and travel from infected countries, and boycott companies that spread disease are common Twitter refrains often led by public figures. It's safe to say we face a tough dilemma. The movement of people may facilitate the spread of CAPS, but interruptions to travel and trade may have economic consequences that are just as bad.
The outcome of the CAPS pandemic in Event 201 was catastrophic. 65 million people died in the first 18 months. The outbreak was small at first and initially seemed controllable, but then it started spreading in densely crowded and impoverished neighborhoods of megacities. From that point on, the spread of the disease was explosive. Within 6 months, cases were occurring in nearly every country. At first, wealthy countries with advanced healthcare and public health systems were primarily able to limit the spread of the disease within their borders. As systems became overwhelmed, however, no countries were able to control its spread. And the disease affected people of all socioeconomic status, from the very poor to the extremely rich, from sanitation workers to CEOs and national leaders. The economic consequences were dramatic. The high death toll and even greater numbers of sick hurt productivity in many industries. Manufacturers were having trouble filling orders, and countless companies in the service sector simply shut down. The global economy was in a free fall. The GDP down 11%. Stock markets around the world plummeted between 20 and 40% and headed into a downward cycle of fear and low expectation. Businesses were not borrowing, banks were not lending. Everyone was just hoping to hunker down and weather the storm. While nearly all businesses were affected, certain sectors were especially hard hit. Travel, finance, service, manufacturing, healthcare, and insurance among them, with some major companies going bankrupt. And there were seismic societal consequences as well. The world saw large-scale protests and, in some places, riots. People were angry about the lack of access to healthcare and medicine, as well as government's inability to protect them from the disease. This led to violent crackdowns in some countries and even martial law. Political upheaval became the rule across the globe. The public lost trust in their respective administrations. Several governments fell, while others were desperately striving to hold on to power. This spurred further crackdowns. Attempts to control media messaging, originally aimed only at health-related misinformation, became used increasingly to quash political dissent. Economists say the economic turmoil caused by such a pandemic will last for years, perhaps a decade. The societal impacts, the loss of faith in government, the distrust of news, and the breakdown of social cohesion could last even longer. So are we, as a global community, now finally ready to do the hard work needed to prepare for the next pandemic?
After the T-virus was released, a secret file was uploaded to my data stream. It was a recording of a meeting of the Umbrella High Command, dated 17 months before the viral outbreak occurred.
We are here today not just to talk about the future of this company. We're here to talk about its destiny. We're here to talk about the end of the world. We stand on the brink of Armageddon, diseases for which we have no cure. Fundamentalist states who call for our destruction, nuclear powers over which we have no control. And even if we navigate these dangerous waters, we face other, even more inevitable threats. Global warming will melt the polarized gaps within 80 years, flooding 90% of all habitable areas on Earth. Unchecked population growth will overtake food production in less than 50 years, leading to famine and war. This is not conjecture, this is fact. One way or another, our world is coming to an end. Now the question is, will we end with it?
What do you propose?
I propose that we end the world, but on our terms. An orchestrated apocalypse. One that will cleanse the Earth of its population but leave its infrastructure and resources intact. It's been done once before, with great success. The chosen few will ride out the storm, not in an ark as in the book of Genesis, but in safety, underground. And when it's over, we will emerge onto a cleansed Earth, one that we can then reboot in our image.
And just how do you intend to achieve this?
The means of our salvation are already at hand. I give to you the T-virus.
Protesters have returned to the streets and cities across Lebanon for a second day, with one demonstrator reportedly killed in the latest clashes fueled by the country's deepening economic crisis. Lebanon has seen months of anti-government unrest, but now that the discontent has been compounded by growing anger at lockdown measures.
Another night of violence in Lebanon. In the northern city of Tripoli, demonstrators hurled fireworks and rocks at security forces, who responded with tear gas and rubber bullets.
We are day laborers. If we work, we eat. If we don't work, we don't eat.
Lebanon's banks have borne the brunt of the protesters' fury. They've imposed strict capital controls on accounts, freezing access to cash as food prices soar.
I'm not
a human and listen to these people dying from hunger.
The Lebanese army has deployed across Tripoli to contain the unrest.
This is the beginning of the road. What you are seeing today is just the start.
Thousands of depositors of a private cooperative bank in Bengaluru. Now, depositors are panicking as the Reserve Bank of India has restricted the bank from any operation except the withdrawal of a maximum of 35,000 rupees of the total balance in any account.
It was the breaking point for many of these migrant workers stranded in India's financial capital. A few hours after Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced the lockdown will continue for another 2.5 weeks, at least 1,500 people gathered outside a railway station. They've lost their jobs and they're demanding transport to take them to their home states.
We aren't getting anything here. The government promised to provide money and other amenities, but nothing has been delivered yet.
We have nothing to do now. We've got small children and they aren't getting anything to eat. What should we do?
Mumbai police deployed extra officers in the Bandra area of the city. Prime Minister Modi acknowledged that the lockdown to combat COVID-19 has been particularly hard on India's millions of migrant workers and daily wage earners.
Residents clashed with police in Cape Town's Mitchells Plain Township as people demand state food parcels. Police fired rubber bullets to disperse protesters who threw rocks as South Africa continues with a hard lockdown.
This is not animals. This is hungry people. These people are looking just for food. Please, I don't think Ramaphosa is doing something. Why not? Then we can rather die of coronavirus than to die in our homes of hunger.
Tensions have flared in poor Parisian suburbs where residents accused police of heavy-handed tactics under the pretext of enforcing lockdown rules. Intimidation and humiliation have gone on for too long.
There have been many more incidents. We want to be equals because that's what France is all about. Equality, fraternity. But we don't feel like we're treated equal. When you come from a suburb, and especially one that is perceived as tense, you're a second-class citizen, and even more so if you're Arab or Black or Muslim.
Life in some of the country's poorest districts has never been harder. Food banks have multiplied. Some here, too embarrassed to show their faces, are coming for the first time.
The hardest thing to deal with is the kids. When they say, "Mom, I want this or this," and we can't pay the bills.
Members of the National Guard are being deployed across the country to help states mitigate the other painful reality from the pandemic, hunger. Lines are stretching for miles in state after state as the millions of Americans now living on the edge are facing disruptions in the food distribution chain. The challenge is expected to get worse.
How long you been here?
8:15 this morning.
8:15.
Like the lines for free food in New Orleans, desperation is growing by the day. Most of these first-time families are filled with fear and uncertainty.
Thank you.
The world is at risk of widespread famines of biblical proportions caused by the coronavirus pandemic. That's according to the UN agency, the World Food Programme. A new report estimates that the number of people suffering from hunger could go from 135 million to more than 250 million.
Lockdowns, economic recessions are expected to lead to a major loss of income among the working poor. Overseas remittances will also drop sharply. This will hurt countries like Haiti, Nepal, and Somalia, just to name a couple. The loss of tourism receipts will damage countries like Ethiopia, where it accounts for 47% of its total export.
I propose that we end the world, but on our terms, an orchestrated apocalypse.
Weil sie zu weit gehen und weil ich meinem Verstand glaube, dass der gute Entscheidungen treffen kann. Und ich kann auch mich beraten lassen von Menschen, die sich besser mit dem Virus auskennen. Aber ich möchte nicht gezwungen sein, diese Maßnahmen einzuhalten.
Empty streets have become the new normal during the COVID-19 pandemic. Thousands laid off or furloughed, stores shut down, public gatherings banned, travel restrictions and physical distancing imposed, as a third of the world practices some form of a lockdown to slow down the spread of COVID-19. And all of this is having an impact on our global economy. Industries like airlines, import-export companies, tourism, retailers, events, restaurants, and many other non-essential services have been hit.
Border shutdowns and business closures have prompted fears of a recession or even a depression.
Well, U.S. airlines are also bearing the financial brunt of the coronavirus. The pandemic has brought the entire industry to a virtual standstill. Air travel has dropped as much as 95% since mid-March, and airlines could lose $250 billion in revenue this year.
This is an economic crisis, and it's not just a Boeing issue. This is an issue for airlines. This is an issue for their Boeing's top competitor, Airbus. This doesn't seem to have an end in sight, and we're starting to see demand drop down in the United States. You're seeing these rock-bottom fares, you know, double digits. Coronavirus is an airline story. It's a travel story.
Virgin Atlantic has asked staff to take 8 weeks of unpaid leave and is cutting the vast majority of its flights. Norwegian Air is cancelling 85% of its flights and temporarily laying off over 7,000 employees. EasyJet is set to ground the majority of its fleet, while British Airways is cutting flying capacity by at least 75% through to May. And the result of all this is possible bankruptcy across the industry by May this year.
Two in three F&B businesses surveyed by the Restaurant Association of Singapore expect business to be hit hard by COVID-19. Now, they expect a 50 to 70% loss of revenue over the next 3 months.
The virus's other devastating effect, economic decline. In the last 3 weeks, the National Restaurant Association says nearly 70% of kitchens in the U.S. have laid off staff.
Solomon Green with the Urban Institute warns the coronavirus crisis could be followed by a housing crisis.
We need to be planning now for that cliff.
Green says millions of Americans need long-term solutions to keep them from losing their homes if their jobs don't survive the pandemic.
Renters are more likely to be hard hit by the crisis. They tend to have lower incomes. They also tend to work in the industries that we're seeing are losing jobs.
We've seen half of the market just disappear in less than 60 days.
Springtime is Greensboro's busiest season for buying and selling homes.
Showings dropped about 70% over the last 2 months.
Now, the coronavirus shutdown is hitting the housing market pretty hard. Housing start data this morning collapsed 22.3% in March. And the latest data does show fewer listings and fewer people have been out shopping for homes.
Global economy enters an unprecedented shutdown. Just look around. Major League sports have left the field. Factories and shopping malls are shuttered. The lights have gone dark on Broadway, and the curtain has come down for Manhattan's independent theaters like the Magnet Theater.
I'm sitting here in an empty theater, and it's empty every night. We're shut down. New York City is shut down.
We're shutting down the economy to protect our health.
Stiglitz believes that the pre-virus economy was one where too many were left exposed, where both families and businesses alike were at risk if conditions soured.
Before the event, many of our households were living at the edge.
Wall Street has lost.
It's been a frightening ride for investors. Stocks have plunged more than 30% over the past 5 weeks, ending the longest bull market on record.
An orchestrated apocalypse.
From coast to coast tonight, the faces of a deeply personal unemployment crisis.
We were already living paycheck to paycheck, so it just kept snowballing.
I never thought that I would be out of a job.
All the bills are coming and they're calling me and I have no money to pay for that.
The worsening unemployment picture is simply staggering, skyrocketing in just a month from a 50-year low to nearly 17 million seeking benefits in just the last 3 weeks. But that number is most certainly underreported.
Well, we now see an extra 5.24 million people filing for unemployment benefits for the first time in the past week.
The U.S. House of Representatives is meeting to vote on another tranche of bailout funds as a further 4.4 million Americans lost their jobs. Well, the latest unemployment numbers are pretty stark. New applications for unemployment benefits mean the total number of people who have lost their jobs since mid-March is now 26.4 million. That is around 15% of the U.S. workforce. And this graph shows the huge spikes in unemployment, which happened extremely quickly as those lockdown measures brought the world's biggest economy to a standstill. Polls that you can see in grey, they indicate a recession. And basically what this graph tells us is that the jobless claims of the last 5 weeks are in fact more than five times worse than the five-week period of the Great Recession.
Well, there's no doubt the COVID-19 crisis has created a huge burden on our economy. But this morning, Treasury Secretary Dr. Stephen Kennedy put our financial woes into perspective, saying that while unemployment reached higher levels in the Great Depression, we've never seen such a hard and fast drop in jobs.
Remembering that we came into this with record levels of leverage, record levels of overbought in the general risk-on markets in January, early February. So we came into this with all sorts of problems hiding with the momentum of a massive bull market, which again leads me to feel extremely concerned. This is an unprecedented situation. This is worse than 2008. This is worse than 1987. This is the worst crisis to hit financial markets since the Great Depression.
Italy's Prime Minister warns the coronavirus crisis could lead to the collapse of the European Union.
The Eurogroup has overcome sharp differences and a possible crisis inside the EU, agreeing on measures that could reach €500 billion to cushion the economic impact of the coronavirus outbreak.
This is totally unprecedented. We never, ever reacted so quickly to a crisis as this one.
The Federal Reserve staging a massive financial rescue.
I've never seen anything like this.
Pumping an unprecedented $2.3 trillion to support businesses, states, and cities.
The pandemic is also damaging the European economy. The German Economic Research Institute, IFO, said that the country's economy, the largest in Europe, is likely to shrink 9.8% in the second quarter.
The coronavirus pandemic is triggering a dramatic recession in Germany. Financial activities have shrunk massively.
Now, France's central bank says the country's economy shrunk by 6% in the first 3 months of 2020. That's the worst slump since 1945. This estimation from the Bank of France would mean the French economy is now in recession.
It is now quite clear that the EU has entered the deepest economic recession in its history.
The European Union predicts its economy to contract 7.4% this year.
The COVID-19 outbreak has impacted nearly all economic sectors and has caused unemployment to skyrocket.
Unemployment is set to increase, though policy measures should limit its rise. The impact of the pandemic will be felt on the labor market.
U.S. GDP numbers just out, and the world's largest economy shrank by 4.8% in the first quarter. That's the sharpest contraction since the 2008 financial crisis.
My own numbers are unfortunately a lot worse. The IMF numbers that I have here are a lot worse. If you take the year as a whole, the IMF projects minus 7.7% growth for the U.S. I think we may be at minus 10 to minus 14% growth for the U.S.
Some of these people think you can just flick the ignition switch and the economy starts right up. No, the economic damage will be so severe. You're going to have corpses of businesses that will never reopen because they've sold their assets. They have no revenues.
But a lot of the retailers say if this lasts throughout the month of May, then they're going to have to follow suit with that. If they're continued to be closed down basically across the country with no place that they're taking in any revenue, that gets to be a much tougher scenario.
So that's what scares me most, Becky, is that we are going to have a series of bankruptcies and a series of sovereign defaults. So we are going to see people unable to pay because there's no revenue coming in. Models are not built for no revenue coming in. So the big risk out there is that we get defaults.
So some stunning and unprecedented developments in the oil industry today, Richard. Tell us about that.
Never seen anything like it. The price of oil, Janella, went to zero and then kept on falling. It closed at negative 37 bucks per barrel.
Wow.
Down 300%. Wow was right. It means if you're an oil producer, you're going to have to pay someone to take that barrel of oil off your hands. The social distancing lockdowns around the world have slashed demand for oil. We're not driving as much. We're not flying as much.
And all this has rocked financial markets around the world. The worst sell-off on Wall Street since the financial crisis in 2008. Growing fears the virus could tip economies into recession.
We are looking at another day of extreme volatility. Stocks opened just moments ago with the Dow down more than 600 points. And this week alone, stocks have now wiped out nearly $3.5 trillion in value. This morning, stocks in the midst of their worst week since the financial crisis. The Dow plunging more than 3,200 points in just 4 days. After hitting record highs just last week, stocks are now down nearly 11%. Goldman Sachs predicting that the biggest companies in the U.S. may not grow at all this year because of the coronavirus. The ripple effects across many industries. Companies that rely on travel like Marriott and United Airlines warning the outbreak will negatively affect their business, while others like Nike and Apple say factories shuttered in China have delayed production. Facebook canceling a major conference, and America's largest private company, Cargill, joining a growing list of firms banning travel for employees.
I propose that we end the world, but on our terms, an orchestrated apocalypse. And when it's over, we will emerge onto a cleansed earth, one that we can then reboot in our image.
I think that there should be some consequences if in the end, you know, China was responsible for all of this.
Well, the answer might very well be a very resounding yes. But if they were knowingly responsible, yeah, then there should be consequences.
It could have been stopped, and it could have been stopped short. But somebody a long time ago, it seems, decided not to do it that way. And the whole world is suffering because of it. 184 countries, at least.
The Trump administration's top diplomat has hardened his position on who's to blame.
We can confirm that the Chinese Communist Party did all that it could to make sure that the world didn't learn in a timely fashion about what was taking place.
And he echoed the president's claim about the pandemic's origin, saying there's enormous evidence coronavirus came from the Wuhan Institute of Virology.
Remember, China has a history of infecting the world, and they have a history of running substandard laboratories.
President Trump has said if China was found to be knowingly responsible, there would be consequences.
We're going to be given a very strong report as to exactly what we think happened. And I think it'll be very conclusive.
Is there any suggestion that it was anything nefarious or that it was just a mistake?
So I think they made, personally, I think they made a horrible mistake. and they didn't want to admit it.
If this turns out to be a biological weapon, KT, if this happens to be a conscious and overt act on the part of the Chinese military, what should be the response?
If China has unleashed chemical biological warfare on the world, not only the United States, but on the world, then I think it is the beginning of a new Cold War, which they have started.
View the invisible enemy as a war. I don't like how it got here, because it could have been stopped. But no, I view the invisible enemy like a war. Hey, it's killed more people than Pearl Harbor, and it's killed more people than the World Trade Center. World Trade Center was close to 3,000. Well, we're going to beat that by many times, unfortunately. So, yeah, this we view it as a war.
Here's a theory. The Third World War is already on. We just don't see it like that. And one country is making some brutal but winning moves. China relies on stealth and deceit. Strategic moves that are not entirely confrontational. Moves that do not cause immediate shockwaves. Tactics that are hiding in plain sight. Tonight, I have five very important developments that will tell you how China is exploiting a crisis of its own making. Five steps. First, selling the world medical gear after making them sick. Second, taking over distressed companies after damaging the global economy. Third, stockpiling cheap crude oil after causing an oil price crash. Fourth, hoarding grain as the world faces a potential famine. And fifth, pumping money into the WHO to control global platforms.
Meanwhile, China has deployed warships and its aircraft carrier Liaoning to waters between Japan and Taiwan. A Chinese ship was also recently sighted off the Vietnamese coast. And earlier in April, a Chinese Coast Guard vessel reportedly rammed a Vietnamese fishing boat.
China's intent is to so overwhelm the region with its navy, its Coast Guard, its militia, its fishing fleets, that Southeast Asian governments decide that there is no reasonable choice but surrender.
We shouldn't put up with any of it, but we particularly need to send a strong message to the Chinese. They think they're getting away with it. They think they're going to come out of this crisis.
What is the message? They're going to be what is the message?
Our world is coming to an end. Now the question is, will we end with it?
What do you propose?
I propose that we end the world. But on our terms. An orchestrated apocalypse. One that will cleanse the earth of its population but leave its infrastructure and resources intact. It's been done once before, with great success. The chosen few will ride out the storm, not in an ark as in the book of Genesis, but in safety, underground. And when it's over, we will emerge onto a cleansed earth, one that we can then reboot. In our image.
Je suis la résurrection et la vie. Celui qui croit en moi vivra. Quand même il serait mort. Or, la vie éternelle, c'est qu'ils te connaissent, toi, le seul vrai Dieu, et celui que tu as envoyé, Jésus-Christ. L'Esprit du Seigneur est sur moi, parce qu'il m'a oint pour annoncer une bonne nouvelle aux pauvres. Il m'a envoyé pour guérir ceux qui ont le cœur brisé, pour proclamer aux captifs la délivrance, pour renvoyer libres les opprimés. Vous êtes la lumière du monde. Une ville située sur une montagne ne peut être cachée. Que votre lumière luise ainsi devant les hommes, afin qu'ils voient vos bonnes œuvres et qu'ils glorifient votre Père qui est dans les cieux. Je vous donne un commandement nouveau. Aimez-vous les uns les autres comme je vous ai aimé. Vous aussi, aimez-vous les uns les autres. Père, l'heure est venue. Abba. Père. Toutes choses te sont possibles. Éloigne de moi cette coupe. Toutefois, que ma volonté ne se fasse pas. Je remets mon esprit entre tes mains. Je vous laisse la paix. Je vous donne ma paix. Je ne vous la donne pas comme le monde la donne. Que votre cœur ne se trouble point. Vous aurez des tribulations dans le monde. Mais prenez courage. J'ai vaincu le monde. Car Dieu a tant aimé le monde qu'il a donné son Fils unique, afin que quiconque croit en lui ne périsse point, mais qu'il ait la vie éternelle.
Vous apprendrez plus sur ma rencontre avec Jésus-Christ dans Jean chapitre 3, versets 1 à 21. Qu'avez-vous appris de cette histoire? Comment pouvez-vous appliquer cette histoire à votre vie? Laissez-moi vous raconter certaines des choses que j'ai apprises de cette expérience, ce que Dieu m'a enseigné. J'étais perplexe à propos de cet homme nommé Jésus. Je savais qu'il était un docteur de Dieu, mais je devais en savoir plus sur sa personne. Jésus m'a dit que je devais naître de nouveau. Il m'a dit que je ne pouvais pas voir ni entrer dans le royaume de Dieu à moins que je ne sois né d'eau et d'esprit. Ces mots m'ont beaucoup troublé parce que je voulais faire partie du royaume de Dieu. Tout d'abord, je n'ai pas compris quand Jésus disait que le Fils de l'homme devait être élevé tout comme Moïse éleva le serpent. Dans le désert, Dieu laissa vivre les hommes qui avaient reconnu leur péché et regardé le serpent de bronze sur la perche. Ah, mais lorsque j'ai vu Jésus élevé sur la croix, ces paroles ont à nouveau traversé mon esprit. Il faut de même que le Fils de l'homme soit élevé, afin que quiconque croit en lui ne périsse pas, mais ait la vie éternelle. Croyez-vous que Jésus est le Fils de Dieu, le Messie, celui qui est venu pour vous donner la vie? La vie éternelle. Dieu vous aime et veut que vous vous repentiez et que vous vous détourniez de vos péchés et demandiez à Jésus-Christ de vous sauver. Êtes-vous enfin disposé à croire et à recevoir le salut en présent qui vous est offert à travers Jésus-Christ? Si vous voulez vous repentir et placer votre foi en Jésus-Christ, je vous invite à prier avec moi maintenant. Seigneur Dieu Tout-Puissant, j'ai besoin de toi. Je te remercie de m'aimer au point d'être mort sur la croix pour mes péchés. Je me détourne de la voie des péchés et invite Jésus-Christ à pénétrer dans ma vie comme mon Sauveur et Seigneur et faire de moi la personne que tu veux que je sois. Je te remercie de pardonner mes péchés et de m'offrir le présent de la vie éternelle. Amen.